the tail that wags.
Hello, everyone. I hope you're having a great day. Before we start today's video, this week's Gnaw on this question is, where and when and why did the practice of docking dogs' tails begin? We'll get into this controversial subject at the end of today's video. Now, to know more about the care, well-being, and overall enjoyment of dogs, go ahead and hit the subscribe button along with the notification bell so you can be apprised of all things the tail that wags. And now, let's talk breeds. The Rottweiler. The Rottweiler, a wonderful and gifted dog. We know the great country of Germany has perfected and loved one of their national treasures, but how did the Rottweiler come about? How does this dog serve his communities? How does a Rottweiler protect and love her family? And what are some of the myths about this pup? The ancient Romans loved their dogs, whether it was for guarding, hunting, fighting, herding, or just the family pet. Dogs were a part of everyday Roman life. Drover dogs were crucial to the success of the Roman army. Refrigeration was not yet invented, and thousands of men had to be fed. Cattle runs went with the Roman army, and cattle was butchered for the soldiers as needed. In addition to fighting in battle, the Romans employed their dogs to walk, herd, and protect the cattle. Drover dogs drove cattle as Rome marched through Europe. The Molossian is the breed of dogs the Romans used. The Molossian dogs are now extinct and thought to have arrived in Molossia from the giant dogs of Asia, possibly crossed with Italian Mastiffs. All Mastiff dogs are descended from the Molossians. As these dogs marched over the Alps and through Europe with the Roman army, they mated with local dogs on the way. In addition to some of the Molossians, dogs were left behind by the Roman army. This is thought to be the origins of the Rottweiler. The Romans established the small German town of Rottweil in 73 AD. The town grew and was known for its Roman villas with red roofs. The name Rottweil translates to red villa. Rottweil is where the Rottweiler dog began. The German people perfected Rots to the dogs we know today. From the 12th century to the 1900s, the town of Rottweil was known for cattle herding. Much as their ancestors did, Rottweilers were drover dogs. Once the cattle was slaughtered, Rottweilers would then haul the meat to be sold to various towns. This is why Rots are also known as Metzgerhounds, or the butcher's dog of Rottweil. Once the meat was sold, the cattlemen would place their earnings in a purse around their Rottweiler's neck to protect it from thieves. It's a great idea. Who'd want to fight this fella? The Rottweiler almost became extinct. In the mid to late 19th century, the rail system came to Germany and the rest of Europe. The drover dog was simply not needed anymore. Consequently, the Rottweiler population plummeted, with one Rottweiler being showed at a dog show in Hebron in 1882, a renewed interest in the Rottweiler grew. In 1901, the Leonberger Rottweiler Club was established. The club developed a written standard for the Rottweiler, including physical and temperamental guidelines. In 1905, the Rottweiler was selected as a fine dog of unusual breed and irreproachable character. Subsequently, Rottweilers were used as police dogs and served in Germany during World War II. Various dog breed clubs were started, but in 1921, the Allgemeine Deutscher Rottweiler Club, the ADRK. The ADRK published its first stud book in 1924, which is still used. The first Rottweiler came to the United States through Ellis Island in the late 1920s, and more were imported regularly in 1931. In that same year, the Rottweiler was admitted to the American Kennel Club's 1931 stud book. Rottweilers grew in popularity in the U.S. after World War II. Moreover, in the 1990s, demand for this pup exploded and 100,000 Rottweilers were registered to the American Kennel Club. So what's the difference between the German Rottweiler and the American Rottweiler? Remember, the Rottweiler is one of Germany's national treasures. Germany perfected the Rottweiler, set the standard for the Rottweiler, and are diligent in keeping the integrity of the Rottweiler. Not to say America doesn't love their Rottweilers, but the standards aren't all the same. When demand grew for this pup, unscrupulous breeders were motivated with making money rather than keeping the integrity of the breed. Although both the German Rottweiler and the American Rottweiler have few variations, there are two agreed upon. The German Rottweiler is usually bigger and more robust. Furthermore, the German Rottweiler does not have a docked tail. In fact, tail docking is illegal in Germany and much of Europe, including the UK. Rottweilers are great service dogs in a variety of capacities. Rottweilers are strong, intelligent, sensitive, and loyal, which makes them great police dogs. But Rottweilers are C&I dogs, emotional support dogs, therapy dogs, and general service dogs. For example, Rottweilers were used in the aftermath of the Oklahoma City bombing and in 9/11. They were search and rescue dogs as well as cadaver dogs. In addition, Wind, a Rottweiler, won the 2015 Canine Excellence in Therapy Award. In fact, the American Rottweiler Club Pet Therapy Program trains Rottweilers to help children read, visit nursing homes and prisons. And like the dog Wind, Rottweilers also help soldiers work through PTSD. Rottweilers are so loyal to their family members, they will risk their lives for the ones they love. A woman in South Africa was walking her two Rottweilers when a tiger came out of nowhere and attacked her. Her Rotties got to work, and a witness stated the bone-crushing fight was worse than he ever could have imagined. The Rottweilers won the fight. But one Rottie lost his leg and the other will limp all of his life because of the tiger's powerful canines ripped through the muscles and tendons in his leg. This case was unusual as these Rotties had intense training. However, Rottweilers are powerful. The force of their bite is 328 pounds of force, only second to a Mastiff's 552 pound bite. To put this in perspective, a smaller 8-foot-long great white shark has a bite force of 360 pounds per square inch, and a tiger has a bite force of 1,050 pounds per square inch. Because of this strength, Rottweilers have gotten a bad rap for being mindless, vicious animals. Unfortunately, there are many incorrect myths about the Rottweiler, but let's dispel five main ones. Myths about Rottweilers. Rottweilers are aggressive and vicious. Rottweilers are dangerous with children. Rottweilers should be kept outdoors. Rottweilers can't be around other animals. And Rottweilers have unpredictable temperaments. The first myth is that Rottweilers are aggressive and vicious. No, they are not. They're very sensitive, loving dogs. Again, with every dog that you have, early socialization and training is necessary. Rottweilers are sensitive and loving dogs, and if they are trained properly and loved properly and treated properly, you're going to have a fabulous dog. The second myth is Rottweilers should be kept outdoors. This is absolutely untrue. As I said before, Rottweilers are sensitive and loving dogs. Any dog you keep outside just for guarding, don't pay much attention to, you're going to get a very upset and depressed dog that's going to have a lot of horrible behaviors. So no, Rottweilers especially need to know that they're loved and they need to be loved by their family. So keep them indoors with the rest of the family. The third myth is that Rottweilers are not good with children. This is completely untrue. Rottweilers are very loving and sensitive dogs, and they will fight for their families. The thing about it is, you need to teach your children how to be around dogs, how to respect dogs. You need to watch your dogs and your children play. You need early socialization and training, as well as affection for that dog. And then that way, your Rottweiler will be one of your child's great protectors. The fourth myth is that Rottweilers are not good with other animals. Again, early socialization and training will prove that to be false. Now, Rottweilers are a dominant breed and they have a high prey drive. So you do want to be careful if you have gerbils or rabbits in the home. But if they are socialized at an early age, you're going to have that Rottweiler love whatever dog, cat, or animal is in the home with you. The final myth is that Rottweilers have unpredictable temperaments. Again, this is not true. I sound like a broken record, but I'm going to say it again. Early socialization, early training, and love and affection, proper treatment, will keep your Rottweiler one of the best dogs you'll ever have in your life. So love your dog, be with them, and respect them, and learn about your dog, and you will have a Rottweiler that you will remember and love for the rest of your life. The Rottweiler is a majestic dog with a fascinating history. They are strong and protective, yet sensitive and loving. Every breed is not for every person, and the same goes for Rottweilers. But if you adopt a Rottweiler or any other perceived dangerous breed, you have a responsibility. All dog parents have an obligation to love and cherish their dogs, but be honest with yourself. Do you have the time and resources to constantly train, to properly feed, to give daily exercise along with attention and affection for your dog? Rottweilers especially need these things. All dogs do. This week's Gnaw on This question is, when, where, and why did tail docking begin? Well, let's find out. Tail docking is the practice of removing part or all of a dog's tail. This procedure is usually done when a dog is a puppy and is primarily performed without anesthesia. It all started in, you guessed it, ancient Rome. Their Molossian dog tails were docked when the puppy was 40 days old. Docking along with clipping the pup's tongues was performed to prevent rabies. We now know that doesn't prevent rabies, but what about injury? Throughout the years, hunters docked their dogs' tails to prevent injury during the hunt and from livestock accidentally damaging tails during herding. Moreover, docking was done to prevent burrs, sticks, and nettles from burring in and damaging the tail. In the 17th century, England taxed dog parents who had a pup for companionship. However, hunting dogs were not taxed, and hunting dogs' tails were docked to distinguish working dogs from pleasure dogs. The irony of the practice, at that time, it was commonplace that regular people didn't want to be taxed and had their pups' tails docked. Hunting was a hobby of the rich, and the rich did not dock their dogs' tails to show they had the money to pay the taxes. The dog tax was repealed in 1796 and the rabies vaccine was created in 1885, yet docking continued. During the Victorian era, people of the time believed that dogs whose ears were cropped and tails were docked was attractive and desirable. In the decades that followed, veterinarians around the world questioned the needs and benefits of docking. Veterinarians know more about the psychology and physiology of dogs, bringing into question the practice, how necessary it is, and how harmful it is to the dog. It was thought that puppies felt no pain when their tails were docked. However, it has been proven that puppies not only feel the pain of docking, that pain has lasting effects on that puppy's life. Furthermore, dogs communicate through their tails. Studies show that dogs with docked tails may actually be at a disadvantage when communicating with other dogs. In addition, dogs may be standoffish with other dogs whose tails are docked, as there is no direct display on how that other dog is feeling. Many in the veterinary community determined tail docking to be unnecessary and damaging to the canine. As a result, docking has been banned throughout the world. There is controversy about docking, as hunters are concerned with their dog's tails being damaged. However, study shows that 0.23% of dogs have injuries to their tails to warrant amputation. In addition, many police departments dock their dogs' tails for fear criminals may grab the tail during a takedown. Some dogs relentlessly attack their own tails until that tail is severely damaged, and amputation is the best and sometimes only option. Though there are many veterinarians who refuse to dock a dog's tail in these countries, Canada and the U.S. are two of the few countries who have not yet banned docking. As a matter of fact, the American Kennel Club requires some breeds, like the Rottweiler, to have their tail docked to show. Quote, tail docked short, close to body, leaving one or two vertebrae. The set of tail is more important than length. Properly set, it gives an impression of elongation of top line, carried slightly above horizontal when the dog is excited or moving. If you have the option and want your dog's tail docked, employ a reputable veterinarian to perform this medical procedure. There is a valid risk of pain and infection coupled with neurological and physiological ramifications for your dog if done improperly. Tail docking is a controversial subject. It was started in ancient times and through the centuries kept up for various reasons. The practice continues primarily for aesthetic purposes, but if and until the practice is banned worldwide, you must use your discretion and conscience to make your decision.